discuss the first part of the meeting, the public hearing, where we discuss with you the different wording articles that are being proposed. Then we close the public meeting, and we have a planning board meeting where we vote on each one of the articles, whether we're going to present at a town meeting this year. So we could say we're going to make a change. We could say it's as good as we can get it. Let people vote on it. Make their choice. So this is our board.
John Schneider.
Chris Marco.
Logan Smith.
Where's Ben?
Ben's down there.
And we have from Central Regional Planning Commission, who's been helping us with the language and all the technicalities of this, from Central Regional Planning. One map.
Matt Tiffin, yes.
Yep, Matt here.
Yes, he is. I think they're working on copies.
They're making some more copies, yes. Okay, so item one for us to discuss is Article 12, to comply with FEMA Flood Zone Regulations. All of these board articles have been up on the website for over a week now. Lois is getting some copies made right now, which is running behind, but we'll have 10, 15 copies here for people to look at. The floodplain ordinance, I don't know if you looked at it, it's for us to come in compliance with FEMA terminology and regulation so that people in town who are in the flood zone can get FEMA flood insurance. And if we have a natural disaster, then they can apply, or anyone affected can apply for FEMA insurance, FEMA disaster insurance. FEMA disaster insurance helped me very much in my business when I was, my business was in Brooklyn, New York, along the Gowanus Canal. We got totally flooded by Sandy. Thank goodness for FEMA. So questions, comments, thoughts about that?
I just had a technical question. If there's an amendment to any of these, do we still have time to have another meeting?
If we decide in the board session after this to make an amendment, then we have to vote on it tonight and get a public notice out tomorrow, the 19th, for a meeting which we have scheduled. Sorry, I forget.
Lois would know, but she's not here.
Yeah.
So you do have time.
Yes, yeah. Yes, but only one day. And not even 24 hours, actually.
It's be Monday the 29th of this month. It would be the possible second meeting.
I didn't do it. So any questions about the FEMA issue?
So, Greg, you alluded to your experience with FEMA in New York. Does that apply to Canterbury? Does FEMA apply to flood insurance for businesses as well as residences?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
I'll just add that basically this ordinance is just housekeeping. The wording, some of the technical wording, it was made to match the federal government wording with the archaic wording that Canterbury had in the ordinance. It's to make, a situation like Sandy or some of these other places, if a situation like that does, everything lines up, our ordinance with the feds. So that's all this is. We're not really changing anything or adding anything to it. It's just making the terminology
Come into compliance
with the federal words. That's all it is. So, and it's our understanding that the girl that worked on it down at Central New Hampshire, it affects very little in the town.
Yeah, there are very few people in the flood zone.
So it just lines up.
Excuse me. There's a girl?
Yeah, there's a girl that works with Matt.
A young lady, sorry.
Misspoke. A young lady that worked on the terminology and got everything,
qualified professional.
All lined up.
Uh,
quick question, does the terminology, does the terminology affect anybody who previously would have been within like the FEMA flood zone or defined in that said flood zone, or is it only going, is it only affecting the people who are already in that, within that same terminology? So in other words, it's not changing the terminology that all of a sudden makes somebody who previously would have qualified not, it's purely to bring it back in?
So it's just everything stays the same. It's who would have qualified before, still qualifies. If you didn't qualify before, you still don't.
There is a there is a change. There are new maps. So
the
there
maps
is,
may change some.
The maps are changing slightly.
But the word
so there's probably more acreage in town that would qualify for FEMA insurance and disaster.
So the expectation is that if anything, it would increase the amount of areas that would qualify opposed to reduce.
Correct.
Because it looks like you guys are eliminating that zone A or AE and then just designating it as a special flood hazard area. Does that sound about right? But you're also saying on the town map, you have a area where it is floodplain or flood area.
Yes, we have to change terminology in different places in order to be in so that they all line up.
Gotcha.
So that we're always using the same terminology. We have that in a number of these ordinances where we were trying to clean up. I'm not talking about apples and oranges and potatoes, but try to make them all the same.
Do you expect this to potentially affect residents who would you expect the designation to potentially impact people getting insurance that are in this area, in some of these areas?
It's my understanding that if we don't adopt this, then the people that are getting flood insurance and qualify for flood insurance now will no longer qualify. So we're trying to stay in compliance so that everybody can keep their flood insurance. That make sense?
It does.
Falls into the category of very necessary changes that we'll have to go on anyways because that's how the system works.
It's fair. I just want to make sure that if there's somebody who's not, if their insurance currently doesn't require them to have additional insurance and all of a sudden this this change would, I could see that if my insurance all of a sudden said, oh, you're now a tax map that abuts something that's flooded, floodplain, they might go, oh, you need that extra.
That's a realistic concern.
Yeah.
And with that, and it's not something you have much control over because it is determined by the flood map.
Fair enough. Yep, I understand that. I just think it's just something needs to be brought up if people are on the edge.
Yep.
You just need to be aware that that could affect them. That's
it's more of housekeeping. I mean, this is probably the least controversial. This is just
I agree.
federal wording, their terminology, making Canterbury's ordinance match the federal rules and regulations so that it's seamless.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of getting hiring a lawyer, well, your ordinance says this, does that mean this in the federal? It matches that terminology.
Perfect.
All right, we got a number of things. Can we move on if there's nothing else pressing there? Okay, so next we have Article 13.2. This is proposed by the Historic District Commission. Do you want to explain it?
Sure. we've got two school boards for town meeting. That's where I direct this chairperson. The first article is one that, if you look at the current ordinance and you're trying to figure out if you are in or out of the two districts that are in the Historic District Commission overview, good luck. They're meets and bounds, so unless you've got a survey background, you're probably going to have a hard time. It's complicated by the fact that if you go to the assessor's office, what's on your tax card isn't necessarily the zone, as far as zoning, that you're in. The Shaker Historic Overlay District isn't even a zoning zone, it's an overlay district. So we're proposing that what the boundaries will be officially referenced on the current or the new revised zoning map so that people can easily see, and it will be down to the lot level, which properties are in both the Center Historic District and the Shaker Historic Overlay District, so that you can find out is there an added level of procedure that you have to go through for whatever the historic districts require. Or no, I'm outside that, so I can go on my merry way with the planning board and the code enforcement and everybody else. So again, we propose this to be kind of more of a user-friendly way to find out where are these districts, am I in them, and I'm not. So, any questions? Are those the handouts? Okay, I guess we've got the handouts of both of these amendments. We'll find something in my list.
Which article is
this?
13.2.
13.2, yeah.
The second on your menu for tonight.
Okay, but it's not on the summary list that was posted.
The two historic district warrants are on what just came up.
I think it is on the summary list.
Yes.
Sorry.
Yeah,
it's listed, but
no, it's not.
I don't think the one is no. The actual wording is.
No, you're right. No. Right, so the all of our other zoning districts are defined by reference to the map. And if you looked in the town office, the map next to Mandy's office has yellow and green and magenta on it. However, the Center Historic District is not defined by the map. It's defined by meets and bounds, describing all of the boundaries. So it's going to be bring it into the same format that we have for all of the other zoning, how we determine all the other zoning and look at the map for it. Same with the Shaker Historic, right?
Right, yeah. And we're going to do a little bit of cleaning up thanks to the Central Canterbury Regional Planning. We noticed that the current zoning map where it shows the Shaker Village Museum Preservation District is actually the outline of the historic overlay district, just to confuse matters. So we're going to clean that up because the Museum Preservation District has very high standards, and that is just Shaker Village Incorporated property. That's why that exists that way. So.
Is there, do you have a proposed new map that I wrote for the gap?
I have a draft of it. Yeah.
Well, we vote.
Well, again, we're not changing the boundaries. The boundaries that we currently have, and we have had made up actual enlargements for each of those. It's so hard to see.
Right.
Is this a road? Is it a stream? What is that? So those were made. The problem is that when you put them in the zoning map, the information in the assessing office doesn't line it up, so it creates a goofy thing.
Will there be an extended view? Because some of the zoning map is kind of small.
Yeah, in the Historic District Commission, in our revision of all the regulations, the first thing you want to do is blow it up to the lot level so that you can clearly see which lots are in the district.
So let me address the map issue and the timing on the maps. The maps are being redone as part of the master plan process, which we've been working on it for 5 years, but the final maps are not finished yet and won't be finished. The master plan won't be finished until probably June or something like that. So there'll be more opportunities for people to look at the maps and have input on them.
I have some kind of rough working thing that we're working on.
Is that version on the website?
No.
Let's get it out of there.
It's not. Well, it's not done.
Well, finish it.
They got this to me in one day, so I'll give kudos to that for sure.
So that's the map part, and what was the other part of the bill?
So the second warrant article?
Yeah.
The second warrant article is, again, the HDC proposes that we add an option to the current approval making process, so that if you come to us, the HDC, in the past there have been very many small projects that don't have public visibility, probably if not definitely won't abut or have any impact upon the abut. And quite frankly, to go through the public hearing process of notifications and all that, what we found is the burden of that cost and time added to this process generally has people going off on their own and hoping it works out for the best and not coming through the process. So what we propose is that you can file an application just as you normally would. You have to state all of the things you're going to do that fall under the purview of the HDC materials, and all those standards are still going to apply. But if it's something that won't have public visibility, won't affect the abutter, I'll get to how we determine that, and it's still in the spirit of the ordinance, we will be able to waive the public hearing. We can still have the discussion amongst the HDC. It has to be signed off by the chairperson and the board of selectmen representatives. And this is so that, again, try to keep accountability there, but also help townsfolk who say, geez, I just want to put a portico over my porch. It's on the back side of the house and my neighbor's 35 acres away. I really have to go through that process. No. You can design a portico that meets all the standards and it meets the criteria of this option. We'll let it go through and off you go. So that's the intent.
Well, they've got to get a building permit.
You still require all the other things, yes. But as far as the another hearing and more money and more time extension to have a public hearing, we're trying to cut that. And if there's any doubt, obviously, the HDC would just bear on the side. Well, we're not quite sure. And go through the normal process.
Questions? Saving it by turning it into a residential unit, maybe with for us, the planning board and the zoning board, is that a place like Canterbury Hall is a beautiful example of how a homestead conversion could be. There are a number of, there are three living units in there, I believe, and then there's some room rentals in part of it. And so in order for that to be legal, they had to get a variance, which is a very difficult level of compliance and a very difficult thing to accomplish. So we're trying to make it so that some of these historic structures and historic looking structures can be repurposed in a way that's going to, in a way that can support them so that they can maintain them. You look across the street from Peverly Hall, and we see that beautiful old farm with missing half the barn on the back of it. We thought that maybe if they could have turned that barn into two living units, maybe they could have supported the property in a different way. Everybody gets to make their own choice about their property, but I thought it looked like nice the way it was before. So, open to questions, comments? Yes, sir.
You don't see a lot of cluster developments in Canterbury right now. It kind of contradicts what you're saying about how easy it would be to make a cluster development.
We approved one last year, and there are a couple that are very similar to that. The Cambridge Drive, Heflon Road are similar kinds of things. They were built quite a while ago, you're right. But we're trying to anticipate development pressure and to try to form a way that makes it happen more in what we call what everybody wants, to preserve the character of Canterbury. We're faced with a lot of state regulation that says, like the ADU thing. The ADUs, the state requires that we allow an ADU in any zone that allows single family houses. There's a lot of protection in the law for landowners and developers, and the town has to be very careful about justifying the any restrictions that we're going to put on them.
There's a lot to digest in this in this document, just so you know.
Yeah, there is.
We've spent a considerable amount of time creating it.
But to summarize it the way you are, I appreciate you doing this for sure, but again, there's a lot more to it than presentation.
They've been on the website for well over a week, and there is also a version that is redlined that shows you all the differences, so I hope that is helpful.
Yeah. But again, a lot to digest.
Yep, there is.
So does the board see this as the board primarily see this update as a buttress then, not necessarily something going on right now, but just something that you're anticipating then, purely as that?
I think that is one way of definitely looking at it. I think there are two sides to it that. In order to make it more defensible, it seems we have to make some things more possible. Make it more possible to do it in a Canterbury way, in a way that doesn't, that preserves the character of the town. So you're making that easier while you're making somebody that wants to come in and put 80 houses across Sunset Hill, making it hard. Yes, sir.
Is there anything in there that I know the town isn't real anxious to pave the new roads in these clusters, but is there anything in there that would prevent a developer from going to the town and asking the town?
No, it says specifically that if the developer brings it up to class 5 standards, I don't think it uses class 5 standards anymore. I think we're changing to town approved standards, just the terminology, that if they do bring it up to town approved standards, they can approach the town to have the town take on maintenance of the road.
Because there may be circumstances where the town wants to do it.
There may be.
It has to be approved by town meeting.
Yeah,
I understand.
Right.
Of course.
Right. Right, that, it's a pretty, pretty high bar. You could go through the whole, the state regulates how the town can lay out a road, I'm sure you're aware of that. Yes, sir.
This could be a stupid question or repetitive, but when you talk in terms of clusters, the amount of housing or units available per acreage, how would that translate to conversion of farm buildings? You know, if you got a Canterbury home, 3 acres, are they going to be limited to only utilize two spaces for housing, or can you utilize the maximum size of the building to get 10 units, even though it's on a 3 acre parcel?
There's a 5 acre minimum.
Okay.
There's a 5 acre minimum, and you're not allowed to have more than one unit per acre.
So that applies whether it's clusters or multi units in a farm style?
No, the cluster neighborhood, no. The farmstead, farmstead only.
So the farmstead conversion, it's a 5 acre minimum.
Correct.
And the density that's allowed, it would be up to one unit per acre. But in the cluster, it's the same density.
Same thing, I'm just curious as to the amount of units you could put in a conversion versus a cluster.
Right, and there's a max, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, the maximum number of units still applies to regardless of the size of the barn involved.
I didn't know if you would try to change that to accommodate, you know, where a lot of these farmstead conversions would be, you know, they're in ag zoning. So I guess that would be in conjunction with changing the accessibility to get a cluster to open up the ag versus not. So then that would translate
a lot to the units. The board felt there was a good bit of resistance to allowing this conversion in ag, and it is not in the revised table of uses.
Okay.
It is a lot to digest and think about, so please take your time. Yes.
My comment is, I've been to all these meetings that you've had here, except for one, but I got to watch the recording. Thank you for the recording. I appreciate all the work you guys have done. Nobody wants to see more development, more trees cut down, more driveways going in. There are some going in around town right now, and it's hard to see. And cluster development, those two words sound kind of scary. But I think Tyson did a great job at the last meeting describing that visually, where you've got 100 acres and it's not going to be 25 acre lots with 20 houses on it. It's going to be a cluster in an area so the remaining open land stays open. And that's the Canterbury way. That's part of what I think what you're hearing from people is we still want to protect our resources and our open land. But housing is inevitable because there's a drastic shortage in our state and in the country. And the estimates based on our population growth is we need, in the state of New Hampshire, 60,000 new houses.
Yeah, that's a scary number.
By 2030, that's 6 years away. There is a housing crisis out there. People need a place to live. We're living here right now because our son is still with us. We need more places for people to live. But no, the point is just that I feel that what I've heard from all these meetings is that you are really trying to prepare the rules in such a way that will protect our character for when those developers do come knocking on our door. And they're gonna show up.
They've already started showing.
Right. It's just a matter of time. I mean, people need a place to live. So I think we need to be part of the solution and not part of the problem. And we need to find the creative ways that suit us in this town. I applaud you guys for all the work.
Thank you. I think I neglected to mention another important part of this warrant article, which is the old version talked about public space. The definitions were very loose, and they were, you know, it was like, okay, can they put a swimming pool and have a, there's a swimming pool for their people on that, that dedicated land, or can they not? And so we tried to clarify that if the part that you're leaving open stays undisturbed, you cannot put tennis courts on it. If you want a tennis court, you have another land. You can put your tennis court on common. So we have dedicated common land, which means you can't do anything to develop it. And then you have the organization, the homeowners association common land. And if you want a pickleball court, you can put up a pickleball court. But you can't do it on the dedicated section. You can also get in the bonus, density bonus, if you were to put in a soccer field that somehow that was open to the soccer school soccer program, the planning board would consider that as part of a bonus program that would help you get to your 10% so that you can get another unit. Yes, sir.
Why is it limited just to one area? Why is it not opened up to agricultural?
Okay, so they're permitted in residential, in rural, in the center. There's part of the Shaker historic overlay where they're allowed, as I understand it, in compliance with their reasons. As we've discussed this in public meetings, there's quite a number of people that were very concerned about expanding this into the ag conservation area. I think personally that eventually it is a direction we want to go, but I also think personally we did not have adequate protections, and I think we need to even tighten up those protections. If we're going to allow 20 houses and 100 acres of dedicated open area, does that need to be public access? Do people need, does the whole town have to use that? Do you have the right to use that? And we talk about it being, we added that it had to be in the deeds that this was, that the dedicated public area was to be undisturbed. But I'm still not, and this is also in conversation with the Conservation Commission. Is anybody from the commission here? So they are very much in favor of the cluster neighborhood option because it is protected open space. They would like to see it in the ag conservation area because conservation, that's where you're trying to conserve the land. They were also very concerned about the deed language and the protection language. And I felt that it was, I think the board felt that let's do a little bit and continue working on the protection language. And if we find out that this is something that's going to work out and that the public is going to be okay with, then maybe we can expand it. Right? Sorry, that was a long answer. Yes, ma'am?
I just want to clarify, so no matter what, if we vote for this, we go to a meeting and we can say no to anything that's proposed if the town votes against it, correct?
That's correct. Yes, sir.
Sorry, just a point of clarification. Hypothetically, if there is a piece of property that would fall within the availability to do this cluster neighborhood, and a portion of it was designated as being community property, whatever. What's to prevent that property owner from years down the road trying to split off the property? Is there anything that makes it so that it is locked in based on that cluster neighborhood, or is, I'm just asking that as a...
Yes, we have written that in the deed, because we also wanted to pay taxes on that land, right? I mean, it's probably in current use, it's not going to be current use, but in the deed, that piece of property is deeded to the homeowners association, and the homeowners association has to maintain it as specified in the ordinance. But I'm concerned, I have concerns about it.
But what we have in the new ordinance is way better than what's in the old ordinance. The old ordinance hardly defines it at all, and which is why we changed it, because we were concerned about the property, the owner, that saying, well, things have changed. My intention has changed. I want to put 10 houses in. Trying to protect it from that.
Yes, sir. Multi-dwelling units in this proposed cluster development, is that, I'm just scrolling through this, and I'm not, is there any restrictions? Or is that, would that be allowed?
Multifamily is allowed. You made no changes, we made no changes in view what's allowed.
We were approached by, me and John were approached by somebody that's sitting in here, and apparently there's some buzz about the cluster development, and I guess the buzz is that some people are concerned about it or whatever. Development is inevitable. It's coming. It's breathing down our neck. Marked away down next to Woodbreaker, down near the New Market Basket. That's a huge development that's being proposed for down in there. It's just a matter of time before, especially the I-93 corridor, that stuff is going to get pushed up into there. The cluster development does two things. Number one, it protects Canterbury and keeps things. And we keep hearing in the public hearing, it keeps things the Canterbury way. You know, it takes and compacts, it puts a development within limits, depending on how big the property is. You can only put so much development in there, but then it compacts it and provides open space. As Greg alluded to, there's two types of the open space. If they're going to develop it and they want to put a swimming pool or a pickleball court, that counts towards how many houses that they can put in there, because that's their footprint. What they have to keep open as open space, and the residence common area versus the designated open space. So the majority of it, because of the cost of development, that's the bigger area, and that's alluded to when that development goes in, there's an HOA that covers those houses. In that deed is that open space. It can't be developed. So it's locked into with the subdivision itself.
Yeah, I guess the concern would be that where's the teeth to this? Because if the HOA goes under, the HOA decides they're not going to follow up, where is the teeth? That it seems like this cluster neighborhood is pushing toward development, but only in a cluster. It's incentivizing cluster neighborhoods opposed to single family dwellings. So I guess my concern is, from a simplicity sake, we understand how single family developments work, and we understand who the owner is, we understand how to make remediations if there's an issue between the town and that particular owner opposed to a whole HOA. Seems like that's...
The difference between it is like, say you have, say 20 acres.
Sure.
Okay. They can subdivide that 20 acres into 5-acre lots, put four houses up. Individual houses.
Yep.
Or it could be one house with 20 acres if somebody's got the money. But the cluster development, what it does is it allows them to take and put and develop, it's compacted, and the rest of the area around the houses stays open.
Keep in mind also that the cluster development ordinance exists already. The updates that we're making are more restrictive about maintaining that open space than the existing ordinances.
But I think that you have legitimate concerns about this, about HOAs going under and stuff. So I believe that we have improved the situation and protected more against it, but I think there is more work we can do. And I would invite you to join us at the planning board over the next year, propose a revised ordinance next year. I'm serious.
That's the plan.
Can you speak to, if you did a cluster and you had 10 dwellings, right? So if you had a cluster of 10 dwellings in the little 20 acres, is that single family dwellings, or does that also incorporate like a multi-family unit as well? Because 10 families is different than 20 families.
It can be single family houses, it can be two family home, and I think it's maxed out at six. But that six max, seemed high to me, but that is what is in currently in the ordinance, and currently in our ordinance for the most zones of multifamily, six unit is allowed.
But you could not have more units on a given property because you were putting some of them in a single building.
Right, it's units, not buildings.
Oh, well, that was death. Okay.
Yes.
I was pretty sure that was your dwelling. Yeah, a dwelling unit is a home, whether that's within a building that contains multiple dwelling units or only one.
I was just concerned, like 10.
Yeah, no, your question is very reasonable concern, but yeah, not a scary thing.
Oh, sorry. Yes.
How would you guys, as Rich stated, you know, development's inevitable, it's coming. Say somebody proposed 2 to 3 cluster, whatever you want to call them, cluster subdivisions, units, neighborhoods. How would the town address that in conjunction with the 3% growth? I mean, I don't think there's ever been a year we've seen more than 3 to 5 houses built in town.
Are you getting ahead of us? Because that's going to be, if we look on the summary page, Article 11, that's going to be talked about next to last. Next to last on the agenda.
All right, I'll get you at the end.
In other words, how many can come in Canterbury? There's a limit.
I was saying, in a given time.
Yes.
You got 20 proposals.
The cluster is subject to the cluster and the farmstead conversion, all subject to the growth cap.
Okay.
Yes.
Could it be 3 stories? Yes, it could be a 3-story. We also have a height ordinance. There's going to be talking about but the height ordinance, I'll just get that. The height ordinance, the purpose of it is to keep buildings of a height where the fire equipment that we have can adequately service them. We don't want to buy bigger fire trucks, I don't think.
3 stories.
So it's 45 feet, which is more cluster neighborhood?
Yeah, I just have a quick one. So we talked about what the town responsibility could be in the future for if somebody wanted to apply to have the town maintain it, et cetera. At what point, when it becomes an issue with, as far as if we're adding, you know, a 40-acre lot is allowed, you know, 20 acres of that to be developed with 50% open space and all of that. So if we have, even if there were single families, if we have 20 families come in, you know, with that many more added people in town, at what point and whose responsibility is it to go through the process of having to upgrade all of our town municipalities or our school for capacity?
That's a very good question. So the growth cap is allowed under state law called the innovative, help me out, Tyson, innovative use planning law or something like that.
Innovative land use RSA.
And it requires us to justify that cap. We have to have a capital improvement plan that shows that we have growth of X amount per year and that we have planned it out, and that's why we have a 3% cap, because we can't, we're in a good situation with that, because we don't have public sewer, we don't have public water.
Right.
But when do we need more people in the fire department? When do we need more people in the police department? When do we need a new cruiser? When do we need another fire truck? All those things are part of that capital improvement plan, and that's how the state allows us to apply those metrics to our growth.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Sorry, one other question. For the preserve spaces, I think someone over there might have asked as well, what would prevent that preserve space from being, blocked from public access? So in other words, depending on what could be abutting, you may have a situation where there may not be any public access to that. So is there anything in there that, because if you, I'm thinking of a cluster neighborhood, maybe there's a gate that's there or some sort of limitation to a neighborhood. I don't know. I'm just trying to say, like, is there
yes,
any...
It's a good issue, something we've bandied about a little bit. Right now, the dedicated open space, undisturbed open space, the commitment is to keep it undisturbed open space. It is not required to have public access. Public access is a separate item in the density bonus. So if you're putting together your density bonuses, and you say, okay, we don't allow public access on the open space. We're going to have a common septic system for each six units is going to have a common septic as well. What are some of the other bonuses?
Public access is encouraged but not required.
What are some of the other dental
construction of stone walls, maintenance of
Maintaining stone walls that, on the front of the property where they're viewable by the public.
If they got a bonus for allowing public access and then stopped allowing public access, that would be a select board enforcement sort of issue.
And yes, the enforcement is always an issue.
Yeah, we learned about that in the zoning board. That's always up to the select board to actually decide whether they want to enforce it or not. So that doesn't really have teeth. I know you guys know that, but...
We can only make the rules.
Fair. I always say is it's easier to put it in now than to claw it back later. That's all I would say to that, so...
Well, our feeling is we've got a lot in. What we could manage to get in now is better than it was, and we're planning to work on it more with your assistance next year.
You promised we're going to
Yes.
Is it
likely that open space of 1 acre is going to be in current use, and there are certain forms of public access, depending on what kind of
work?
Yes. Entirely possible.
Yes. One thing I have thought about, but we are not sure it's legal, is to say, you were asking about teeth. What are the teeth for this? If they've got 20 acres of dedicated space that's in current use, if we have the authority to say, if you're not following the rules, you lose your current use, that would be a big incentive. But if it's a wealthy enough group, it's not going to be that big.
The current use doesn't require to be open to the public.
Right.
You get a recreational discount if you do it.
Yeah, right. And all the easiest. Oh, another bonus you get is if you're contiguous with currently protected land. So if your plot is next to a place that already has a conservation easement on it, then you get a little bonus for that. Because you're making a bigger section of unrestricted.
And allows for longer like corridors as well.
Right, exactly.
Overall, we've tried to do as much as we can to encourage large areas of undisturbed space. You know, to the extent that it is possible to do that, because it is ultimately people's private property that they can make other choices about.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir. Just a clarification on that designated open space. I saw in the requirements you have there, 50% of the total land area, is that total developable land area that's being buildable, or is that total land area? So
that's total land area.
So
if you're putting on an interesting...
Five of it's a swamp.
Yes.
That's still included in the open space.
We have somewhere in the ordinance that you can't have more than 10% of wetland. But I'm not sure that's in there now. But that's another thing we need to work on.
Sure. Thank you. Very helpful.
maximum height on a building, except the commercial area where you can go higher if you have permission.
Basically, don't build buildings taller than the fire ladders. You shouldn't want to, it's a bad idea. And we would like there to be a rule that says you can't.
Questions, concerns? Other check mark.
The town would burn out ordinance?
Go ahead.
I was just curious if it was variable or not, or if it was a set height. So if next year somebody wanted to get a larger ladder, want to pay for it in the commercial district, all of a sudden is that up there?
You know, there's a story about that with the motor speedway.
Yeah.
Is when they wanted to put in the big, those tall stands, they said, don't worry about it, we'll buy you a new truck.
Yeah.
Well, then 10 years later, they needed another new truck.
Yeah.
And there weren't any money coming.
I believe we just bought a new truck, so.
Where was Bob?
By the time we're due for another new truck, you can look at updating the ordinance again.
Moving on, public hearing to revise Article 5.2, establishment of minimum lot standards to specify flagpole height. This is about the character of, the town. Rich would like to have any type flagpole you want.
I was against this. I was kind of like the stick in the mud because if I could, I would.
You squeezed another 5 feet out of us.
I would have the flagpole that's on in Epsom on Route 4. I can't this world.
Please,
that would be in my yard.
That's why we need this.
Because I am extremely patriotic. And I'm a veteran, and it's just, there isn't any flag that is too big, in my opinion. So I compromised because in this ordinance, I gave in on the height, but we also had the size of the flag that could be put on that flagpole. And Gregory went in and took that out, and I said, okay, I'll compromise on the height of the pole.
So one of the issues here is First Amendment rights. If I can put up an American flag, you can put up a Taliban flag, or any, we have no ability to control what people put on that flagpole. So let's all have just a reasonable size flag.
For advertising.
Advertising, no wind-blown advertising allowed in this town. Different part of the order.
I think that's the sign
of the thing. The things are the
same.
Didn't know that existed.
Any questions, comments, concerns about flagpoles?
Lighting in our ordinance, and we were required to have downward facing cut off, quote, dark sky lights, all new lights that go through the permit process have to be dark sky compliant.
Which means they're shielded. They can't just have an open light.
You know, we used to see those security lights on the top of a telephone pole without any shielding around them. You can still have it on the top of the telephone pole. You can still have light on your property. You have to shield it so that it doesn't shine off.
And there's not like a distance from the road or anything like that?
Streetlights are always pretty close to the road.
Well, yeah. It's just, you know, we've never had a streetlight on our road before, and we have one now. Sorry, I was just curious.
Dark sky compliant is different than your just run-of-the-mill light. You know, what you're used to maybe is seeing the street lights, those aren't dark sky compliant.
So is this a new light?
So
it's an LED light, it just seems particularly bright.
Yeah.
Yeah. Talk to your compliance officer.
Is there enforcement afterwards? Because you drive up Shaker Road and certain times those floodlights are right in your face.
I had one on our
police officer or town code enforcement, but what it is they violate law, you can only sue them. You can take it judicial.
It's not so much that, it's that in this town, because of this unique smallness of it so far, is that you've got volunteer boards that are doing volunteer work, and it's not their responsibility to go out and keep track of what's going on out there, even though we may drive by all the time and see something that the event, like a bar.
They are volunteer, but the select board is in charge of enforcement. And actually, they are talking about a proposal to add a land use person into town staff. Yes, it costs money. But part of that job description is enforcement, to help with enforcement, because you talk about it, position, you talk to the people, you talk to Mandy, you talk to Joel, building inspector, and they say, we need help with enforcement.
And I guess that's where I was going. Fact that there is a need on the tail end of all this to have a mechanism for a person that is checking these things so that they have a reason to exist.
The place for us, the planning board, to make a statement about that is in the master plan that we are working on, and we will make some statement encouraging the town to treat enforcement more seriously. I know we haven't discussed the language, the only thing we hear about more than roads is enforcement. All right, I'm going to check off the flagpole. I already did. Public hearing to review Articles 25 and 18 regarding the requirements for a permitting process of accessory dwelling units. Sorry, we didn't have all of these copies here before, but I've got some ADU copies here. Here, now I have red line. Oh, here's some red line. ADU red line. Even more. ADU, additional dwelling unit. I have two kinds of additional
red line.
So, all right, Rich, I'll let you have a floor.
Red line? Red line or clean?
Hey, Rich.
You don't care? Red. Two reds?
Yeah.
Thank you.
I'm coming.
We're trying to keep us going here so we can all get out of here for some reason or other. Additional dwelling unit. So I mentioned before that the state requires us to allow additional dwelling units in any zone that allows single family dwellings. So that's pretty much all the town. We have two kinds of ADUs, additional dwelling units. One is attached. That means it's either part of an attached to your existing primary residence. And we have detached, which means it could be in a separate building. Like if you have a separate garage, you could put an ADU building. Or you could build a separate little building that would be an ADU. An ADU has to be a complete living facility. Kitchen, bath, all the sanitation. These have been quite successful in town, in my opinion. There are quite a few of them. They've gone a long way to relieving some of the housing problems for residents specifically. If your kid is still at home and you're trying to build a career and you don't want them in your house, you can build an ADU.
Why are you looking at me?
You can build an ADU. You can put the kid in the ADU.
Yeah.
Or you can live in the ADU.
It's called what you get.
So what are we trying to do about this?
sorry, I'm just following up. Oh, the permitting process. Right, so ADUs have been successful, they're very well defined. So we're proposing that in the changes in the table of uses, we change it to being an allowed use rather than a special exception. Special exception means you have to go to the zoning board and get a special exception to build your mother-in-law's apartment. If it's an allowed use, you go to the building inspector and you say, okay, here's my plan. Does this comply with everything? Most importantly, does my septic support it? That's where many ADU projects go awry, is that they don't have an adequate septic system to support an additional bedroom, right? Or additional bedroom and kitchen system. So I think that's the big change.
Yeah, the detached ADUs, you have those in there, and they also go, those actually go through a conditional use permit.
Yes, the detached is still a conditional use permit. So there we'd be looking like at things like, is it too close to your neighbor? Could we put it in the middle of the field that we'd rather see it on the field there? If you move it up somewhere else where it's going to be more traditional.
Are there any changes to the actual requirements of the ADU, or is it stay out of the detached 7,000 square feet?
1,000 square feet, the same stays the same. By the way, the state minimum is 750, so we have to allow 750. Most towns allow only 750. We're quite generous in allowing 1,000 square feet, which is really, thinking about it, a two-bedroom apartment with two baths can easily be fit in 1,000 square feet. No, it's not that small a space. The other thing that's unusual about Canterbury is that we allow the detached. Most have them attached only. We have a limitation of 500 feet. It has to be within 500 feet of the main dwelling. This we think is mostly about emergency services. You can't put it, a mile and a half out in the woods, and you could expect the fire truck to get there or the ambulance to get there.
One other little thing that we did was, this goes back to when it was probably written, and the acronyms that were put in. So when you read this, it was ADDU and a DDDU, and by the time you were wondering, after you read it all, you wondered where the U's and where the D's were, which one was which and everything. We took those out.
If you hit that,
and we put them, we put the plain language in place so that it made it less, a little more reader friendly, a little bit more user friendly. Some people love acronyms.
Careful.
But they, it just means it makes the document a little easier.
As long as you're within the RSA. It's just what they are.
Yeah, as long as it is defined.
Oh, can I ask?
Sure.
I think you want to make these things easy to do, and hopefully not so expensive. And one thing I was concerned about was the, it appears that, as far as the septic system is concerned, if you've already got a septic system, and it's adequate to even take care of the additional bedrooms, you don't have to, in the state law, you do not have to build another septic system. You can
That's
get
correct.
A plan.
As long as you have the adequate, you can handle your system, can handle the flow.
Right. So in other words, this is still the same. I had to come up with a plan for a septic system, but I did not have to install it unless it failed.
Yes.
It makes sense.
It's the same standard.
Because a lot of times you're adding another bedroom, and that's it, and it's not a big deal anyway.
Yes.
Those regs are state DES regs.
Right. And finding approved septic tanks in a lot of houses in Canterbury, that's a long time ago. And they were at one point, but they long ago ended up in a roll in somebody's basement.
Well, there was a situation not far from my house where an absentee owner was renting three units in a place that did not have adequate septic.
But that didn't last long, did it? Because you stopped.
No, it did for many, many years.
Oh, did it?
Every time you walked by it, you knew it. More questions, comments? Yes, Stan.
I have a question about the total 1,000 square feet of gross floor area has to be, let's see, so attic, if there's an attic.
Attic's not counted in that 1,000 square feet unless you convert it into a bedroom or something. If you convert it into a bedroom, then it's part of the living space.
My question was, if peak is probably
right.
Going
to be. You're also allowed to have a garage space. Like if you had a building with a garage underneath, that garage space would not be counted as your thousands in your thousands.
Or it would have to be underneath or next to.
Or next, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
I'm ready to check it off. Yes, sir.
Why did we eliminate taking out approval from the zoning board and select board for approving these residential applications? I mean, I think you could still do that with the existing changes that you made to make sure that they were compliant?
It goes back to keeping the complexity and the cost of it down. Because numerous ADUs would go to the zoning board, and most of them would get approved if they were in if they follow, so basically it was double. They were approving it, and then they'd have to go to the building inspector and have to check all the same boxes and get it approved that way.
This makes it way cheaper, and it also makes it more likely that people will go through the process rather than doing effectively unlicensed ADU, which, you know, again, it's an enforcement issue, but if they're not going through the process, nobody's making sure they have a working septic, et cetera, et cetera. So, making the process easier makes it less expensive, less hassle for everybody involved, and makes it more likely that people will go through the process to make sure they're doing a safe and appropriate living situation.
And you get them on the books so that the emergency services know what's going on here.
And
we have additional tax revenue. Moving on, public hearing to revise new Article 2. We're revising the short-term rental article. So the way this was written was very vague. And for example, how many short-term rentals can you have? It was also written before we had the campground ordinance. And before we had the ADU ordinance. So it was trying to fill in some of those needs with the short-term rental. There's also been some issues with too many short-term rentals in one place. So we're proposing that a single-family home be allowed one short-term rental. I think that's the big change, is that you're...
It is probably important to clarify what a short-term rental is.
Short-term rental is under 30 days. It's like the Airbnb stuff, as opposed to the full B&B, where you get a B&B license and all the inspections are there. The short-term rental is a much less difficult inspection and compliance issue, so therefore it's appropriate for, we feel, for one unit, but not for six units. Calvin?
In terms of the instances where there are multiple short-term rentals on one property, it says in here that 2 years, permits good for 2 years. Will those properties be grandfathered in if this
they got, because they're aware that there are a lot of people that have concerns about this. I talk, every time I talk to them, it comes up. And the select board's like any other board. They listen to, the more people that complain, the more action gets taken. So if you have an issue, you need to talk about it.
But I mean, the two or three properties that have multiples, it would be.
Right, so yes, that's a good question. I think they will be grandfathered, but I'm not totally clear on what the law is. The reason we changed from the 5-year renewal process thing to 2 years is so there have been some places where there are a significant number of complaints about what's going on in multiple, or even one short-term rental. And so if the town has on the record that there have been 6 complaints here, maybe they're not going to renew the license. Or hopefully they'll work to solve the problem. Yes,
so
ma'am.
Does short-term rental require the property owner to live on the property?
No, because there are many short-term rentals that are full houses.
Okay.
I said, especially up on in Sherwood Forest, there are a lot of people who have owned homes there and are basically rent them for a lot of the year or rent them for a few weeks of the year.
Okay. And so back, if I can back up a bit.
Sure.
If you have an accessory dwelling unit, are you required to live on the property?
Yes.
So if the property sells, and there's an accessory dwelling unit on the property, does the permit for that ADU go with the sale?
Yes.
Or do you have to restart?
No, that's the ADU exists. It's a permitted ADU. It's something you bought when you bought your property.
Okay.
And if I had the choice between the same house with or without an ADU, I think I'd choose the one with.
Yes, sir. Correct me if I'm wrong. This language deters the ADUs from becoming short-term lodging when it says here the principal use of a lot shall be a single-family home in reference to short-term. So that would disallow somebody from using an ADU as a short-term rental?
No. No, you can't use an ADU as a short-term rental.
Can?
Yes, you can. Or that's my understanding of the language, Matt.
Because a lot that has a house and an ADU, the principal purpose of the lot is the single family home, and the ADU is sort of a secondary
accessory
purpose. It's an accessory dwelling.
So, a second single family home?
A second dwelling unit. If you want to rent short-term rental, you rent your ADU, you have to go to the town and ask the permission to do it and be subject to the ADU and the short-term rental requirements, the license renewal after 2 years, etc.
So the ADU is still a single-family home?
No.
Because if it's not, then this is saying the principal use of the lot shall be a single-family home.
No, the single-family home is the principal. The ADU is the accessory. So, for example, you couldn't do
you can't have a two-family home and an ADU.
Yes, exactly. So, the single-family home as the principal use is the main use on the lot.
So this language does not deter the use of the ADU being used as short-term lodging.
That is correct.
Correct.
Yes.
But you still have to live in the primary house as your primary residence.
If you're going to have residence in your ADU, you need to live. You need to be living there. That has to be your primary address.
The owner can live in the ADU or in the original home, but they have to live on the property.
So what happens in the instance of you have a house in ADU, you decide you want to move to Florida, but you have the means to not sell the house? And you want to rent both spaces?
I understand that. I think the way the town has been interpreting that is if somebody takes on a long-term lease, then they become the owner, the landlord manager. But they have to be there, and they are renting it, not the person in Florida.
Yeah, it's complicated.
Where does constitute a short term? Are you basing that totally on an Airbnb rental service?
No, it's defined as under 30 days, because 30 days triggers residentiary privileges such as voting.
Basically, a short term rental is effectively becomes a rental to somebody who's not a town resident and is not intending to come. So the 30 day limit is sort of in concordance with state laws about landlord tenant issues.
Who would approve this application for
September
2 years you want to reapply? That goes to the building inspector. I'm sorry. So
I think it's a zoning board, isn't it?
2 year reapplication is for a short term rental.
Yeah.
Okay. And it is managed by the code enforcement officer. So the building inspector, he keeps a list of all with the renewal dates and needs to, and actually, our new building inspector is doing a lot more of this kind of thing. And is visiting, you know, has a schedule, of who he's supposed to visit when. You know, maybe it's not totally 100% accurate, but it's better than no schedule. So,
would there be guidelines?
Yes.
Would there be a fee?
There are guidelines to the application. I don't know if there's a fee for the application or not. I shouldn't think. It's like the certificate of occupancy permits. If you have a business, your people are coming into a space, you have to have a certificate of occupancy that says how many people you are allowed to have. And that's determined by the building inspector, who comes, looks at it, issues a piece of paper saying certificate of occupancy up to 19 people or up to 7 people or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't think there's a fee for that. I was trying to address the fee question. For new applications, there's always a fee. Something we're thinking about is having a reduced fee for amendments to a site plan. Like somebody's got a site plan and there's whatever on it, and they want to do something small, you know, a carport, for example. It should be showing on the site plan, but it's not a whole site plan review. So we're proposing for next year. We're talking about proposing a bridged or a more user friendly, less expensive process for a site plan amendment, and again. A lot of it is about trying to encourage people to come in and tell the town what's going on so the town knows what's going on, rather than flying under the radar. Moving on to short-term rentals. Yes, sorry.
Just a question. Are there any zones where it is already a permitted use for a short-term rental? I didn't think there was any zones that had it as a defined permitted use. I thought they always required variance.
Don't know off the top of my head, sorry.
Because there is a variance process for the zoning board, and that already has its own 3 year limit, I believe, 3 year timeline.
Now has a 5 year.
Right, but I'm saying. There's a difference between, there are some zones where I don't believe short-term rentals are a defined use. You'd have to get a variance in order to do that.
If it's not, if there's a dash, it means it's not allowed in the table of uses.
Mm-hmm.
The dash means not allowed in that zone. But I'm trying to find short-term rentals.
It's only in the industrial district where it's not allowed currently. And it's by special exception in all the other districts.
So a special exception. I think that was your question, that not a variance, a special exception.
exception.
Special exemption, I probably should say, not variance, I apologize, wrong wording, special exemption, but. But you still need, the special exemption still needs to be approved by the zoning board for that short-term rental.
Right, and there has to be public notice that said whether they.
Right, but I thought the short, I thought the special exemption already had a shorter limit than the 5 years. So I'm pretty sure, I thought the special exemption had a 3-year renewal.
It was five.
I mean, I'm wrong on that.
We're changing, we want to change.
We're changing, the proposal is to change it to two.
Two.
So if somebody, you know, say, your neighbor has a, put in a bunch of short-term rental and is making problems for you, you don't want to wait 5 years.
I agree.
Public hearing to revise Article 5 to limit residential use in the commercial zone. This is actually a misprint, I believe, because it's not to limit. Currently, residential use is not allowed in the commercial zone.
Limited use.
And what, where?
No, I think we're ready to misprint on kind of the agenda, but if you look at the summary, it says this would permit limited residential use, so explain all that.
Right. So Oliver is a commercial district on exit 17, for example. It started out as being a home enterprise zone, as how it was promoted by the developers and the real estate people. That kind of morphed into the commercial zone. But when we became a commercial zone, there were still 6-8 houses there. And there's still 6-8 houses. And now every commercial use, every one of these high bay industrial units that go in there has an ADU. They're allowed to have an ADU, that's what our, and so they're being used by, usually they some of the staff, some of the employees of the, whoever's renting that unit is in the ADU. But it could also be somebody else. So what we're trying to do is regularize what is actually happening there. And say, so if there's a big, if there's 6 of these high bay industrial spaces, maybe there can be 2 apartments over it rather than the 1 ADU. Apartments also are a better deal for the tax, for our tax. I don't know if that answers what. So it doesn't affect it in any other area except in the commercial zone.
Some of the conversations that have taken place in the zoning board hearings, when, for example, the McCurleys have come in because they are building small business units there for the ADUs, it's a safety feature. You know, it's a long, dark, deserted road, and if you go down that road in the dead of night, it's not well lit, and having somebody live over a business, you know, with lamps on, you know, up till the evening news or whatever, means that there's a presence on the property. And so I think it's been very successful for that particular setup, those days, and the businesses that have gone into small units to have a small seasonal employees. They've got people that come and just work certain times of the year, staying there.
Right.
Or service people that just take their trucks out in the morning and come back at night. And so that's sort of the impetus for that.
So carrying on from that, exit 18, where that little convenience store was, ours. The building is still there. One of the big problems they had was that there was nobody living around there, and it was so easy off on the highway that they would have continual smash and grab, people coming in and grabbing stuff and getting back on the highway. So I think there is definitely a benefit to having some kind of mixed use that includes residential, so that we have eyes on what's going on. I'm going to check it off.
confusing the way this was written before, because it was talking about a limited on building cap, on building permits. Well, a building permit could have two, it could be for a multi-family.
The meeting where we discussed this was very messy.
It could be, it could be four dwelling units. So then when we're talking about the number of existing homes, we were having single-family homes, and now we're having all these ADUs, which are additional dwelling units. So we decided to regularize, rather than talking about apples, oranges, and bananas, to talk all about one thing, which would be dwelling units. So if you're doing getting a permit to add a dwelling unit to your house, that's one of the ones that's counted. If you're building a four unit building, that's four counted toward the cap. Tyson.
One question is, you're counting ADUs of them as units.
Correct.
We're adding a lot more ADUs, 3% and additional one. You're talking about 3% more increases the number of building caps. And this is the way that you're getting more, not building caps, but the number of the size of the building cap is going to be larger.
Yeah.
Yes, but
we cannot reduce the 3%. 3% is the volume.
But it's 3% of a bigger number now.
Yeah.
That's correct.
So
but also,
more, right?
Also, every ADU is counted toward that percent.
Yes.
So
is that what you want?
That's what I believe. We want everything to be counted.
So
we want a higher number of buildings.
We want everything to be the same, so that if you're applying for an ADU, that's part of the 3%. We're having a lot of ADU built in town that are not counted against the 3% cap now. So yes, it will increase our overall number, but when the new ones are built, they are counted against the 3%.
So the number, let's say that for the sake of argument, that like right now we have 900 single family homes in town. Obviously this is nonsense. This is not the correct number. If we add all the ADUs, now we have 1,000, and that 3% cap becomes, what is that, 30? But currently, if I build an ADU, it is not one of that 30 allowable. New rule, it would be. So we're increasing that allowable number per year, but we're also increasing the number of things that count towards that allowable number. This is probably numerically a wash, and currently we're not coming anywhere close to that 3% cap in building permits per year.
Okay, so even if you're building, go ahead, somebody else.
Yeah, just a clarification on what the end result could be is that if some developer came in and put in a cluster development or something, this would shift them from putting in 10 multi-family units to having to be single units or something to comply with the number of permits that they would be allowed.
No.
Yeah.
Multi-family unit count. So if you have six single-family homes, that counts as six. If you have a multi-family with six units in it, that counts as six.
But for a cluster to come, they wouldn't be able to put in 10 six-unit buildings.
Yeah,
because that would exceed the number of allowable permits.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it slows down the cluster development.
We think it is roughly a wash on the increase to the total base number a little bit, but we're also increasing what counts toward the number of permits.
And perhaps most importantly, we're turning this from something that caused a probably hour-long argument with the planning board when we tried to figure out what it actually said, to something that everyone is going to be able to read and understand.
And also, we talk about enforcement problems. You think that something is clearly defined and clearly written, it's an enforcement problem. If it's all confusing and you can't figure out what it means, how do you enforce it?
So the 3% refers to the number of units, not the number of literal permits.
Correct.
Don't ask us what it says right now. There will be another hour of arguing about it.
Well, part of that was nobody could figure out what it said before. More questions?
How long were these existing zoning ordinances in place? And now all of a sudden it's a big problem? You couldn't understand them, but have they been in place for, what, the mid-80s?
The zoning ordinance has been updated every couple of years.
Not like this?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Quite significantly. Well, Tyson, you were on the board, I mean, the...
And I wrote part of this, and I understood it completely, so... It's also legal language, not necessarily for everybody to...
Right.
Without having an interpretation.
Yes, we have. Actually, this has all been, these have all been through town council, who has said, you've still got a lot of problems, you haven't addressed some of these things in way too long, but this is a step in the right direction.
Yep, could I do something further too on this?
Yep.
I noticed you've taken out the planning board exception. The planning board, after consultation with the Conservation Commission, made during the site plan review order that a record holder be eligible for accelerated permit availability if conservation goals are met as a result. Now, that's there for very good reason. One is that we want some of these things to be constructed very well so that conservation land is preserved and it's safe. But in some cases, if you're going to build, you have to build a certain number of units just to be able to afford to do it. So we have in the past negotiated with that builder that if you put certain amount of land here in addition aside for conservation, you can have accelerated building permits. And I wouldn't take this out because it did get us quite a bit of nice conservation land through that deal. So I would reconsider that.
Where this is in which section?
11 point, very top of, let me see. 11.23 permit eligibility, the very last sentence. Exception. Now, it seems to be tied in with multifamily dwelling. I'm not sure this is the exact quote from what our current.
It's the red line one.
This is. Yeah, I don't know whether, but you see what I'm saying? You want to be able to be a little flexible in this, right?
Right, which is a...
You can only build two houses. Well, that makes me $100. I can't do it at all, you know?
Well, that's the whole cluster neighborhood thing.
Right, that builds into that whole thing, right.
Well, currently our 3% cap would allow something that's approximately 27 new units to be built per year.
But not by one person.
No.
No, not a builder who's trying to build enough houses to break even.
Correct.
To get over the hump.
There's a change in that.
Yeah, the new version of this would not limit, or at least significantly reduces the limitation on how many permits.
No single builder can get more than 25%, is what it says now. It used to say that you could, and what's really a problem for what you were talking about is that at the beginning of the year, a builder could get one permit, and then if all the permits were taken by June 30th, then they could get another permit. So anybody wanting to do more than one unit has no...
Unless they met conservation goals by the Conservation Commission can vote to do that, and that's when you can increase the number. And you wanted to do that.
But the new version that we're proposing doesn't put that same limitation on people in the first place.
It doesn't put the one permit only limitation.
Okay.
So we eliminated that or significantly changed it.
But if you were building a cluster, wouldn't you already have the conservation stuff in place anyways to meet the open space, so it shouldn't pull the permitting up? You should be able to build all the buildings at once. Right?
Provided it's under 25% of your cap. Because we didn't want to say, okay, here's one guy and he snaps up all the permits on day one, and then there's another little developer who's trying to do something, or I'm trying to build my house.
If a developer builds 25 units in January, we don't want to say nobody else in town can build anything.
No, but I think what Tyson was trying to say was, if you're putting in six units and you're only allowed to build two at once, there's no cash flow to continue the project. So if this person meets the conservation requirements, they get all six permits at once.
We already do. We've addressed that. What's 25% of 30?
7.7.
So right now, so in the current version, we're allowing 7. And I think they can come back in June and ask for more. Yes, ma'am.
I was just going to say, just adds a little more flexibility to the whole development process. You could talk with the builder, and he's willing to add 60 more acres of land if he can just have 4 more permits beyond whatever it is. You might want to be able to do that.
I see what you're saying, because
you want to have that
conservation allows him to build more, but he can't get the permits. So
you might want to have that option in there. Ask the conservation board that's going to be looking at it and everything. It's not going to be something you're getting tricked out of them getting cram more houses in. It would be a deal that you'd want to have, so you'd have even more land in conservation.
I can tell you want to come back here on the 29th.
I'll trust you to do it.
But Tyson, though, it seems like if you've got 6 more houses, if someone can negotiate, you know, like, well, give me 60 acres if you give me 6 more houses or whatever, that's not just 6 more houses, that's 15 more children potentially that are going to go into a school, and that, you know, 15 more kids is going to like max out our little school. What happens then?
Well, you still couldn't exceed the zoning maximum for that acreage altogether, I don't believe.
So we're restricted on how much we can restrict many things by state law. This innovative land use planning thing allows us to restrict it significantly, but it's based on, I was talking about before, the capital improvement plan. And a big part of the capital improvement plan is school, right? So that figures into what that limitation is. Sorry?
And we need to update the capital improvement plan.
Yes.
But that's not
where
tonight.
That 3% cap comes from, right?
Yes.
3% is the lowest cap that we're legally allowed.
Right, and we have to fortify that or
prove
that it's necessary by the capital improvement.
So, I'm kind of going a different direction than everyone, but I wanted to know if legally can you break offshore forests into its own role like that? So then it limits it to maybe 3 houses a year in there versus being a percentage of the 27, say, that the town gets? You put 5 houses in there, it really kills the road. It's really hard to keep up with that level of development.
I don't think there's anything. There are no lots big enough in Sherwood Forest to put in. There's no 5-acre lots, are there?
I don't know, it's all the cap. The building. I'm talking about the professional land that you're talking about, I think.
Giving Sherwood its own cap.
Yeah, the cap.
Oh, Sherwood is a separate cap.
Yeah, is that possible? Because if you have 100 year round units, say, then you only get 3 houses.
That's an interesting idea. And I understand what you're saying, that your services are overwhelmed.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
So we could, I bet we could say something about, so how many homes are there?
There's approximately 200 properties, and there's probably, it's hard to say exactly how many homes without looking at the spreadsheet, but maybe about 100. So there's still land there that can be built on that really we all know shouldn't be, but they can. So I'm just asking, since we're talking about that, if that's something that can be added to maybe control that a little bit and help us out.
So you're saying try to say, so only we have 100, so 3% is 3, so 3 gives Sherwood Forest is enough, right?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if everyone would agree with me, but I think it would help control it.
Okay, I'm going to put it on my list to it's a whole new thing that we haven't talked about, so it's not going to happen.
Yeah, no problem. I just want to talk about it.
There's an association in there, right?
Yes.
Maybe the
Yeah, just a quick question. So since ADUs are now gonna be as part of that cap, is
yes,
that?
Yes, they are part of that.
Right, now they would be.
Yes.
Right, for that 3% cap. Mm-hmm. I know that we're not hitting that 3% limit in build growth, but I guess my question would be is, like, if you happen to have a year where three developers come in and they each want to put in six units in, and so they get eight, you know, that saps up 18, you know, is that going to limit the number of ADUs that can be possibly built during that year? It's just a trade-off that I'm just trying to say, like, I mean, ADUs are a great thing, and that really typically helps families, you know, single-family dwellings. And
it has a lot more effect on people who already live here, on our residents.
Correct, and so I would just bring that up as a potential, I mean, maybe that's something that could be addressed another time, but just, I guess, just want to clarify that. So it would potentially affect somebody if all of those...
It would affect any building permit for a new dwelling.
You can build an ADU by right, according to state law.
But you still
How are you going to stop it?
You still need a permit.
It's subject to the...
You have to be issued a building permit.
It's subject to the building cap.
And it's subject, right now, it's subject to special exception in many buildings, a lot of places, a lot of parts of town.
But yeah, in the last several years, I don't think we've had more than like 9 or 10 building permits for new dwellings issued in any given year, and the cap at any point in the last few years would have allowed something like 25 to 27.
Right, so I don't think it's a problem right now. It was just more of a clarification.
It's a legitimate hypothetical, but we're not in any danger of it at the moment.
Okay.
Yeah, so
question.
Yes.
Is there a formula for our tax assessor to use to figure out what's a fair pay gap to the town for residential ADUs? You know, my son is moving back here, and he has 4 children. I am not about to move out of my house, but I offered an accessory dwelling unit on it, and he will have 4 children that are going to come into the Canterbury school system. Are we all paying for them, or am I the property owner paying for them? What's the formula for how much?
I talked to Mandy about this.
Yeah, how does this work?
I'm sure there's a formula for that. Ask the tax assessor.
So Mandy is the assessor, and I tried to explore this with her somewhat, and I don't have complete answers, I don't think. But she says when you build an attached ADU, it's assessed just like the rest of your house is assessed. Okay, you've got an extra bedroom, so your tax goes up. You've got an extra bathroom, your tax goes up. You've got an extra kitchen, your tax goes up. If it's a detached ADU, it's a whole, it's similar, but if it is a new structure, then you're taxed on the new structure as well. If you're putting into a garage, you're already taxed on the garage, you're being taxed on the improvements. It, in my opinion, so it's a separate dwelling unit. It does not bring in the same amount of tax dollars as your primary residence. So yes, if you put 4 kids in the ADU, it's hurting the school system. But that's not something we can control. We cannot create a regulation that says you can't live in an ADU if you have more than 2 kids.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just a question. There's nobody in my family coming. Don't
worry. My kids are all excited.
Yeah.
Yeah, really.
We tend to build things, not just.
But maybe you could simply be a place for an older couple, an older person, to be able to stay on the property rather than have to move to a nursing home. It costs a lot more money. So he wasn't necessarily some big bursting of population that's going to tax.
Or you could stay in your place and rent the ADU and have enough money to paint the house.
Right.
If you were keeping four kids in your 1,000-square-foot ADU,
Nobody's gonna do that.
But somebody probably would.
Well.
Sounds uncomfortable, but people do things.
Well, we still have two kids in the 950-square-foot apartment.
It's a wall, I have kids.
That's what we do. Yes, sir.
To help minimize some of this development and impact on the town, people talk about our schools, ambulances, rescue, what have you. I really do not think you guys should be eliminating 11.2 multifamily dwelling permits, because that sets kind of a reasonable cap to having the sprawl of multifamily dwelling units in our town. And then you're planning on trying to open up the commercial areas for limited residential use. I just see this big can of worms opening up as far as too much development. I think we're kind of on the edge of where this could potentially go, being like a massive influx of development in this town. So to help curb that a little bit, do not eliminate 11.2 from this ordinance.
Read the part that you...
All of it. It's a paragraph.
I want to read it real quick. Where you could only issue like 1%.
Maximum 1% of multifamily dwelling units.
I think that may have been one of the sections that we eliminated because it was legally problematic. Do you,
is that the
original?
Matt, can you guys help us out on this?
Yeah, Mike actually has.
Do you have it?
That worked on this. So
I guess the way it reads is that you can only issue one permit for a multifamily dwelling.
1%.
It says only one of these permits each year may be used for a multifamily dwelling and will allow the applicant to build a number of units up to a maximum of 1%. So it's basically one building, and that I think one of the considerations is on your proposed cluster neighborhood, if you did have a farmhouse, for example, or a farmstead that might have five or six units, you'd only be allowed one of those, and that would be the total for the year.
For that location, because it says subject to limitation that the total number of units of multifamily dwelling shall not exceed 6% of the number of year round single family dwellings existing at the commencement of the building year. If the 1% limit is not used up by the first applicant in any given year, then a second applicant shall be eligible for a permit for the remaining multifamily units. So I don't think it's just
Also, it's confusing because it's talking about permits rather than one permit when we're saying that if it's a six-family unit, it's focused. You're counting six. That's six, not one. And because we're not adjusting it by permits, we're doing it by dwelling units.
So really quick, too, 11.1 would just include like units generally, so not the structure. So it doesn't mean they're totally excluded from that. I would read that as they're being part of 11.1 as those are units. If you have a six-unit apartment building, that's six units into the pool described in 11.1.
So.
Thank you.
would point it out is generating permits and looking at units. And the first thing that in 11.2 that says is only one permit. So I think you do address it in 11.1 talking about the number of units. It's confusing. I mean, I'm looking at it.
Right, well, that's why you changed it.
Yeah.
It was sort of confusing. All right, well, the board will discuss that and decide whether we can do anything about it now or have to look at it next year. I'm about to check this off if we don't have any objection. Okay, public hearing to revise the table of uses to reflect updated cluster neighborhood changes and accessory dwelling unit changes. So we've talked about these changes. The table of use is just a schematic way of showing them. Do people understand that? Do people have copies of this? Do we have copies of this? Here it is.
This is what it looks like.
If anyone wants to pick up any of these long form copies of any of this stuff on your way out, please do. Otherwise, we have to recycle it. So, by all means, take a copy of
the
copy.
I don't know.
Folks, listen up, please. Quiet, please.
Now that we're back on the clusters, I did just have a clarifying question about the general cluster development. It was indicated earlier on that conditional use permit would be subject to a public hearing to get public review to be involved.
Yes.
Would the public be voting on the approval of that, or that would just be purely informed?
No, it's just like a special exception or a variance where the public can come in and voice their concern.
But not limited to a butters?
The butters get direct, make notice in the mail.
Okay.
There's public notice posted in the town store, the library, the website. I was looking at logo.
So anyone can come to a planning board meeting at any time, but it is only the butters who are going to get notice in the mail specifically.
Okay.
So there's public notice of the meeting. But not the butters get a letter.
Okay, but the actual receiving reply that the governing body
of that. Okay. Is there a loss of all these functions?
Is there?
The ones across the top and down the bottom. Sure.
No, it is not on there. In the actual ordinances, there's a sheet that says well and large, but it's not on the sheet.
Okay, well, here's a quick, rundown on everything like this.
Talking conversation.
Going across the top zones, A is agriculture conservation, RU is rural, R is residential, C is commercial, I is industrial. So C is commercial, so that's land on 106, exit 17, exit 18. I, industrial, that's only some land at exit 18. Then we have the Center Historic District. We have NR, which is Natural Reserve District, which is some areas that are very wet and inaccessible and important conservation-wise. And then we have the Shaker Village Museum. So then as you go down, A means it's allowed. That means you check all the boxes, go to your building inspector. If you check all the boxes, he gives you a permit. That's like if you want to build a house. Right? Your plans match, plans are in compliance with the building code, your septic substance snuff, you get your permit. Rural, okay, so SE is special exception. That means you have to go to the zoning board and request a special exception. The standards for that, Lisa, are to get a special exception.
There's seven criteria things that I can't tell you off the top of my head, but right. All of those forms and the requirements for special exception are available with the town office.
So you can give us some examples, though.
fits in with the spirit of the ordinance and,
Right, hazardous materials, noise, pollution, just general use, consideration of neighbors.
Determine it's a good thing for the town, basically.
Right.
So then we have CU. All right, so the beginning, the A crossed out means that that's what it was before. CU is what we're proposing it be, and that's conditional use permit. So that again requires public notice, which is a permit issued by the planning board, and we have a list of things that we review looking for. It's all the stuff in the cluster ordinance that we look at. Now, for the cluster ordinance,
What would be the clear difference between a conditional use and a special exception? Is it just that the special exception has a clearly defined list of conditional uses is up to the interpretation?
It's a little more flexible, yes. Okay. But the big thing is special exception is the zoning board, conditional use is the planning board. The planning board can take up different specific issues such as, right, so the zoning board would look at the setbacks, required setbacks in the ordinance and say, you've met it, so you're good. Conditional use permit, the board could say, you know, you're in the Central Historic District, there are historic homes that are right up against your property, we really think you need to move it back further.
Sure.
We don't think it's right for you to be in their backyard.
Things other than clearly defined.
Things that are less specifically.
So it might be 50 feet back from the road, but if it's still a nice old view, try to work it out for whoever is applying for this current resident. Okay, that makes sense.
Want to go on that, guys?
Yep.
Hey, Greg?
Yeah.
Is it possible to add a key down the bottom of this chart to say what CUS, I mean, you just explained it to us, but it would be helpful to have it just at the bottom of the page.
Yes, there is a possibility of that.
And actually, you know, that a CU is, you got to go for to planning board and a special exception to zoning or vice versa, but I think that would be
we'll
a helpful addition.
We'll work on that, try to get that into the master plan.
Thanks.
There are some other things that are for unusual things, like a special select board permit. So if you're going to have an event that has more than 100 people, you have to go to the select board and get a special permit. More questions on table of uses?
Hey Greg, I do have one more question. The instance you just mentioned, is that in the table? Or where is that the special exception for like a use of over 100 people? Is that on?
That is not in the
table. No, it's not, not for
not
the
table.
Zoning ordinance.
Where does that go? Where does that
it's
live?
In the ordinance.
Okay. Thank you.
All right, I'm going to check that off. And so that will conclude the public hearing portion of this, which public hearing means you've been, oh, we've got one more.
Can I just ask a question? Can you tell us what ones of these we're going to vote on the 12th, and what ones we're going to vote on the 15th of January? Like, are some of the
board articles are all voted on the 12th, as I understand.
So all of these, and we come in to vote?
Yes. Here, 7 a.m. to 7 p.m.
No.
No?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yes.
On the 12th.
Yeah. March 12th.
March.
And they'll all be separate?
Each one separate as we put
it. I didn't see the residential, the limited residential commercial on this. That would be a separate one also.
Right here.
Or was it?
Sorry, I don't understand. Question
on the uses.
The limited residential use in commercial zone.
Yeah.
That would be a separate one also.
Yes.
Yeah.
That is not
oh,
you don't have a summary. No,
that's
actually, you do have a summary. It's just that the summary is not.
that's.
But you don't have that, those changes listed on the website, on the PDFs?
Static, it's on the website.
I'm not sure.
There's a typo on the agenda, it should say not to limit, but to.
Permit limit.
We'll get final versions of all of these available for public viewing, like technically they're not 100% final until after this meeting and possible.
Matt, what, so, on the website, when can we, when do we clean up the, so we have all the red lines and the difference, what can we, what's the, are we going to change what's on the website after this meeting?
So your options tonight are, if you wanted to have another public hearing, you know, you can schedule another public hearing.
Tyson's all over that.
Or you could decide, hey, you know, we got what we got, we, you know, vote to send it to town meeting for the voters. And that would be your question when you guys actually consider it and vote on it. That would be at town meeting, and this is the step just before that, where they say, here are our proposals, voters, this is what we got for your consideration.
So the wording, the actual wording of the warrant articles will be slightly different, correct? I was going to say, to see if the town will vote to make changes to such and such, such and such.
I have a question. We're going to put the final wording of the warrant articles up on the website so people can see before they vote, yes?
Oh, yeah, you absolutely should, totally.
I was pretty much 100% certain that that was the answer, I just wanted to say it out loud.
Yeah, you want to have all that stuff listed on there, yeah.
So my question, I think, is, are we just going to do, are we going to leave it with the red line versions, or are we just going to put the final version? Let's just separate, if I have it all matched together, let's do a separate thing, final versions, and then, track. Changes with change, with versions with changes that track or something.
I think that's a good way to do it, so people can see the clean version, because all the track changes is crazy.
Yeah.
But people also want to be able to, you know, to look and see what's actually.
Well, that's actually what it was like before, yes.
Yep. So you have both, right? Go through.
Okay, last chance for public questions for the public, because the board has to vote on.
Oh, the board is vote. I mean, I just had a question. Is the board unanimous on all these changes?
There's a no until we vote.
We haven't voted.
I'm saying that when you're going through this process.
We haven't voted yet.
You haven't voted.
So this is the final. This is
not everybody's here though.
So now we have to vote on each one of these to see if the board wants to submit it to town meeting for vote.
This has been a collaborative process. Like, we certainly don't all agree with each other 100% of the time, but I think what we presented here for town comment, like the board as a whole, is pretty much an agreed and disciplined plan.
Except for flagpole.
Except for flagpole.
I enthusiastically endorse the.
Without actually speaking for 100% of board, who's not 100% here, I would say we're pretty much all in agreement.
There is a quorum.